Good evening. Welcome to Emmanuel Baptist Church. Stand tonight. We want to open our service singing page number 448. It'll also be up on the screens, whichever you prefer. We're going to sing My Savior's Love, I Stand Amazed in the Presence. Sing it out. Sing it like you mean it. I Stand Amazed in the Presence. On that first together. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden, he prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love. Sing it out on that last. When with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Good evening. Hope everybody's doing fine. I hope everybody's nice and dry. Somebody asked me earlier if we was going to cut the heat up. I said, we got a room full of men. I said, we're going to cut the air on. There's no women here. We don't need to be hot. So we're going to be nice and cool tonight. So let's pray. Father, we want to thank you, Lord, for this night you've given us, God. It's been a wet, rainy day. But God, this is what you ordered up for us. And so, Lord, we just thank you for it. God, I thank you for all these men that are here tonight. Lord, I thank you for the safety you laid upon them, Lord, to make a way for them to be here. And God, I pray you be with us all tonight, Lord. Lord, I pray for the message you laid on your preacher's heart tonight. God, I pray that you just fill him with your spirit. You give him what we need to hear as men tonight. Lord, help us to be the men that we need to be in these last days, the Christian men. Help us to be strong and bold in our faith. Help us to be the Bible that so many around us need to see. Help us lead our families. Lord, just be with us tonight. And Lord, I pray if there's one here tonight that's not saved. Lord, they don't know where they're going to spend eternity. God, I pray, Lord, you just get a hold of them tonight. Lord, just break them down tonight, Lord, until they turn to you. Lord, we just thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much for being here. Welcome to the men's conference, and I hope that everything has gone well for you today, because it's getting ready to get better, and all of that, if not already. Let me make several announcements. First of all, thank you so much for taking of your time to be here and to be with us and to spend time with us. I look at this as an investment in being a man. And this world needs more than anything is more men to be men. And so I hope that you've come with expectancy and all of that. And we are so thrilled that you're here with us. Let me make a couple of things. If you need anything at all during the service, if you need a telephone, if you need, as a matter of fact, if you'll do us a favor, take this thing out and either turn it off, put it in airplane mode, silence it, do something, because you know and I know inevitably in a room this size that at some point somebody's going to get a text or a call or something like that. And as happened to us here one time, we had a fella that was sitting in the auditorium, and right as soon as the invitation started, off to my right, his phone started ringing. There's only one problem. He had put a song as his ringtone. And it wasn't Jesus Loves Me either. Would you like to know what the song was? Devil Went Down to Georgia. And that is not a lie. That is the absolute truth. Some of these folks may still remember that. One of these days when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask him if he got scolded for that from the Lord when he got there. But sure enough, invitation time, devil went down to Georgia, and I thought, my soul. And anyway, but please do that. As you come in, every one of you had the opportunity to register and all of that. If you did not and you came in through one of the side doors, every year we try to make sure that we mail these cards out about a month or two in advance. We'd love for you to register. By the way, when you register, they also gave you a ticket for the drawings. Tonight we'll draw for a fire pit from Lowe's and this recliner up here. Now, the company that we get them from, In Your Home Furnishings over in Hickory, really gave a nice one this year. So don't be surprised if, like in years past, if you get your ticket drawn, that there's not two or three people lined up to try to buy that thing from you. And so somebody, it happens every year. So anyway, so make sure you register before you leave. Make sure you register so you can get the ticket. The other thing that we gave you when you come in was one of the 5x7 cards for the spring revival that we're having. Several local area pastors are going to be taking part in that. And I hope that if you've not got anything going on, that anything going on in your church, let me rephrase that, in your church, that if you could make time for that, we'd love to have you. And looking forward to what the Lord will do during that time in March. And it'll be a special time. It'll be Sunday night through Friday night, and so there'll be a couple, three or four opportunities there for you to come during the week there, but we'd love for you to do that. And also, I'm making all of the announcements now so that I don't bore you anymore. In the morning, the schedule will be at 8:30. We'll start with serving some light danishes, some biscuits and juice and coffee and all of that. That'll be down in the fellowship hall. That'll be down this road here and in the fellowship hall on the bottom level. If you go through these doors over here and down the steps to the right and all the way to the end, you can find it. But we'd love for you to come and socialize, fellowship with us at 8:30 in the morning. And then promptly at 9 o'clock we'll start because of weather and because of how the plane is going, the airport and all for Pastor Schmidt. We're going to have to stack the sessions tomorrow. So rather than having lunch then the last session, what we'll do tomorrow is 9 to 10, 10:15 to 11:15, and then 11:30 to 12:30. And then we'll do the lunch and the giveaways immediately after that. So just so if you can't get here at 9 o'clock, can't get here till 10 o'clock, there's still two sessions and all of that. We'd love for you to come. If you plan on coming in the morning, make sure the ladies out back know that so that we can properly prepare for that. And also, after or during the sessions tomorrow, just like tonight, there's snacks and drinks and all that. The only thing we ask is that those soda pops and things like that, finish those up when you're over there and help us out with that. And all right, let's do this. I know that there's several pastors from the area here. So if you're a pastor or an associate or something like that, would you stand up so we can recognize you? Pastors and preachers of the such. All right. Wonderful. Y'all enjoy that just as much as I do. Amen. All right, Brother Steins, if you'll start us off. Yes, sir. Wonderful. Thank you so much. All right. Wonderful. Brother David.
David Watson,
Brother Ryan. Brother Steve. Thank you, fellas, so much. All right, let's do this. Let's stand up, move across the aisles, and at least find somebody you don't know and shake their hand. And in just a minute, we'll get back together.
All right, fellas, if you'll grab a hymn book one more time, or you can look at the screen, we're going to sing It Is Well. I hope tonight you can truly say it is well with your soul. So sing it out, sing it to the Lord. Page 417 if you need it. It is well with my soul. On that first together. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well. with my soul, my sin. Oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. On that last. And Lord, haste the day when the fish shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, well with my soul.
Great singing, fellas. You can be seated. We'll ask the men's quartet to come up and sing before we hear the message.
For a long time I traveled down a long, lonely road. My heart was so heavy, instead I thank Lord that I heard about Jesus. For a wonderful hour, I'm glad that I found out He would bring me out to His saving power. In the blood of Jesus, I've been born again. Hallelujah, save, that's wonderful grace. I'm glad that I found out He would bring me out and show me the way. I've heard out of prison that taken is wonderful grace.
I'm on my way to heaven. Hope you do. And all of that. Listen, I'm so glad you're here tonight. I'm glad that our speaker's here, our preacher's here, and met this fella. I've racked my brain, but we've crossed paths a long time ago. And I'm telling you, between reading his books and listening to the podcast and reading Ministry 127 and all of that, just an absolute blessing to have him here. 3 or 4 years ago, he was scheduled to come. And now he's from Connecticut, or his pastor's in Connecticut, and you'd think there'd be bad weather up there before it'd be down here. It snowed ankle deep down here, and of course that shuts everything down. And so blame it on him. He brought the rain. At least he didn't bring the snow with him. And we're so glad to have Pastor Schmidt. And I'm telling you, grab your Bibles, get them ready, and be ready for God to use him and to teach and preach to us. Preacher, come right on.
Thank you, sir. Well, you guys ready to go? Okay, open your Bibles to 1 Chronicles chapter 19. I have had such a hard time deciding what to preach to you. I got like 5 or 6 things that are just burning in my heart, so I'm just picking one of them. Is that okay? I love the Bible. It's kind of hard to go wrong, you know. There's so many great places to open up and ask God to grow us. Thank you, Brother Correll, for inviting me and for not having snow this year. There's snow on the ground in Connecticut. But that was really weird, because when you invited me, I told him, I said, now, you know, anytime you book something in January, February, March, and you're bringing somebody from Connecticut, there's about a 25 or 30% chance that I'm going to get snowed in, and it ended up being you guys got snowed in. When you guys get snow down here and we don't, we just laugh. We love that, because we know if you get an inch or two, it shuts everything down, you know. For an inch or two up there, nothing stops. Life just goes on. They just start plowing immediately and throwing salt, and it's all good. Let me tell you a little bit of where I'm coming to you from. I'm 50. I've been in the ministry 30 years this year. The longer I live, the less I know, and I don't feel like I know any more, as much as I have just better questions to ask. But God has allowed us. Dana and I have been married 30 years. We celebrate our 30th anniversary last month. And we have 3 kids. Our oldest, Lance, is 28. Oh, that's painful to say that. And he has twins. So we have... Actually, we have 4 grandkids now, but Chad and Charlie are 4, a boy and a girl. Chad's the boy, Charlie's the girl. My name's Cary, her name's Charlie. I don't know, I don't understand it, okay? People say, why don't you trade names with your granddaughter? Just talk to my mom about it. I didn't pick the name Cary, that's just the one I got, you know. But she got Charlie. Something's wrong with our naming schemes in our family. So Lance and Hillary, they're 28. They serve the Lord with us at Emmanuel. My second son, Larry, is 25, and he graduated a few years ago from Pensacola with a business degree, moved to Connecticut, and works at an insurance company there. He's an underwriter and growing his family, and he has one son, Augie, and another son about to be born, and he won't tell us the name of that son, so I just call that baby Cary. It's just baby Cary. I just say, how's baby Cary? So anyway, we have a 4th grandchild on the way next month. Let me see here. We spent 22 years at Lancaster Baptist Church in California, Southern California, And then in 2010 and 2011, I got cancer. And for about a year, I fought cancer. I was 41. That led to about 8 months of chemo, month break, and then about a month of radiation. And then about, I don't know, maybe about 6 or 10 months after that battle, God healed me. I lived, as you can tell, and thank the Lord for that. But about 8 or 10 months after that, God began to break me down and wouldn't let me sleep. And he began to unfold a call in my life. And I tried for a solid 6 or 7 months to talk him out of it. I'm going to share a little bit of that with you tonight. I was afraid. I was worried about, am I making a mistake? Is this a midlife crisis? Is this chemotherapy? Still messing with my mind. And, I mean, I was vetting this in every possible way I could. And at the end of the day, I knew that God was calling us away. Didn't know where, didn't know when, didn't know how it was going to work out. Couldn't see all the details. But finally, May of 2012, 1:30 in the morning, I finally surrendered to God. And what I'm going to share with you tonight is a little bit about a scripture that he, in particular, really used to break me in that particular season of my life. And the surrendering moment was, okay, God, you can have my life. You can have the 22 years we've been here. You can have my home. You can have whatever you want to have. Just give me a good night's rest, because I hadn't had one of those in a long time. When you're wrestling with God, it's a bad place to be. When you know what God's dealing with you about, you don't give in. He loves you enough to persist, and he pursues you, and he runs after you, and he'll wrestle you. And finally, I gave in. And, well, over the next week or two, God began to unveil to us his plan, and it turned out to be quite unusual. He led us to a dying church in Connecticut, and I had never been to Connecticut in my life, didn't know a single soul in Connecticut, had no connection with the church that he was leading us to, and it's too long of a story to tell you how he led us to Emmanuel Baptist Church in Newington, but when I surrendered, I said to the Lord, I don't want to look for a church, not that that's a bad thing to do. I said, I just want you to point me to one. I don't want to shop it. I don't want to send out resumes. I don't want to compare three or four. I just want you to say, this is where I want you. And I said to God, I don't care if it's 10 people in Alaska or 500 people in Miami or some foreign country. I don't care as long as I know it's where you want me. I just want certainty that you are going with me. And I don't really care about the opportunity, fiscally, financially, numerically, any of that. I just want to know that I'm where you are. I want to know that I'm in your will. And so God made it real clear that this was his will for us. I visited the church, and it was, frankly, it was really depressing. And I got in the car with my buddy that drove me up there, and I said, get me out of here. I am never coming to this church. And I wasn't candidating at that time or anything. I was just kind of early in the story. It was a couple weeks after I had surrendered. And the church was, it was a kind of a broken down building. It's a big building, but it was all broken down and kind of neglected. And it felt like it was an abandoned building. It was hard to believe that there was a church meeting there. The parking lot had weeds literally 3 feet tall and leaks everywhere, leaks and stains on the walls and mold and carpet that was 30 and 35 years old. And I mean, it just literally looked like there was a church that met here 25 years ago, but the rapture or something happened, and it's just been left, you know. You ever seen one of those apocalyptic TV shows or movies, you know, where everything's overgrown? That's kind of what this was. And God wouldn't relent. I mean, he just kept after us, after me, over the next, I visited that church on a Monday, and over the next 2 days, he just put my heart in a vice grip, and I don't have time to tell you the whole story, but he called us there, and I finally surrendered, and the church had us candidate, and 93 people voted us in 7.5 years ago, and I didn't know it at the time, but the church, they were debating whether to sell the church property or the school property. There's two properties, quarter mile apart, and in New England, to have two properties, that's a miracle in and of itself. The church was a 1,000-seat auditorium, big parking lot, and no resources to maintain any of it. And so they were planning to sell that whole church property. I think it's 14 acres or so. And then become a small church that met in a school auditorium a quarter mile away. And it would have been a tragic thing for New England because New England is a desert spiritually. It's a total desert. I got to get preaching, but we meet people every single week that have no idea what the gospel is. They've never heard it. They don't know Adam and Eve. They don't know creation. They've never heard it. We meet other people that the only gospel, and it's a false gospel, the only version of Christianity that they know exists at all is Catholicism. I mean, you say Christian, and they have one definition of that, and it's dark, and statues, and crucifixes, and candles, and Latin, and tradition, and no Bible. The Catholics up there will just come out straight out and tell you, I don't know the Bible. The Catholic Church doesn't teach us the Bible. They have no sense, no knowledge whatsoever. So we're literally laboring in a third world country, spiritually speaking. They're either overtly secular with no foundation. It's almost every week somebody's at our church and they tell me, this is the first time I've ever been in the church. Can you imagine? I mean, that's how dark and desolate it is. And there's a Christian community there, but they're relatively inactive. And what I mean by that is they're just kind of the mentality amongst many Christians up in the Northeast is just kind of hide out, hunker down, and you know, don't be too vocal about your Christianity because you get mocked and scorned, so just ride it out, you know, just ride out until Jesus comes. But I don't have time to tell you all the miracles that God's done in the last 7.5 years, but he's revived our church. He's restored our building. We've seen so many people trust Christ as Savior. I don't even have time to tell you even a few of the stories. I just got a text right before the service. I'll tell you very quickly this story. This young lady texted me. She's getting baptized on Sunday. Her name's Deanna. She's the friend of a single mother in our church. This single mother was invited to our church by one of our staff members who happened to be eating in Chili's about 5 years ago. Her name's Sarah. Sarah was eating at Chili's, and the staff member turned around, saw her, and gave her a church invitation. Sarah had just watched. It was right before Thanksgiving, and Sarah had just watched Home Alone, the movie Home Alone. And she had seen this scene where Kevin is in church, and he's sitting there in the candles, and it seemed nostalgic, the Christmas, you know. And she thought, when she's watching this movie, I really want to go to church. She was Jewish, single mom, Jewish, lesbian. And she worked as a bartender at a strip club. And all of her friends were in that lifestyle, either in the homosexual lifestyle or in that sex trafficking world, prostitutes and drug addicts. So she showed, that was on a Monday or Tuesday, she got invited to church, and she showed up that next Wednesday night. She came in with her daughter and sat in the back, and the staff member that invited her during handshaking told me that he had invited this lady, and she was there. He and his wife had invited her. And he goes, Pastor, I'm not sure, but I think she works at a strip club. And I looked at him, I go, okay. You know, like, you know, who are we supposed to reach? People that don't work at those places, you know? He said, she might be a homosexual. I said, oh, that's okay. Look, you know, they need to be saved too, and we'll reach her, and we'll love her. And I watched from a distance. She was trying to kind of be anonymous in the back, and people just flocked to her and introduced themselves and started loving her and expressing how glad they were to see her. She was overwhelmed. Well, she came back Sunday morning. She'd never heard the gospel. Okay, Jewish, single mom, homosexual, worked as a bartender in a strip club. And she came back Sunday morning and Sunday night. She heard the gospel every service. She came back the next Wednesday night. She came for 2 or 3 weeks, and we were nurturing her and talking to her and getting to know her. And she was hearing the gospel, and others were encouraging her. And one night, Monday night, after we'd had a great day in church, I got a Facebook message from Sarah, Pastor Cary. I really want to believe in Jesus. Can you help me? No, I'm sorry, I can't. You know, it was literally a what must I do to be saved moment, okay? And I said, absolutely. Can you come tomorrow to our, we had a staff lunch. It was right before Thanksgiving, so we had a staff luncheon. We were catering in. I think we were catering Chick-fil-A. And I said, why don't you come to the luncheon? I'll introduce you to our staff. And then either me and my wife, or one of our pastoral staff and his wife will sit down with you and we'll help you understand, answer your questions. So she came. She walked in a little timid. By then, we had our school staff, which was about maybe 15 people, and a couple of church staff. And I said, this is Sarah. She's been visiting our church. She hasn't yet trusted Christ as her Savior, but she's really close and she's thinking about it. She has questions about the gospel. And I'm really glad she's here today, and I want you all to get to know her and welcome her. Well, that struck the staff in the school because they said, we've never heard anybody reference publicly a guest that hadn't trusted Christ yet. Well, we do that all the time. When people come, we help them understand where they are spiritually and what their next step would be. And it's just kind of out there. Just, you know, they just know where they are, but they know we love them wherever they are on the journey. And so she sat down and had lunch. She sat down with one of our assistant pastors and his wife after lunch, and they started teaching her the gospel. And they had to start literally in Genesis that God created. Even growing up as a Jew, she hadn't learned the Bible. She had learned Hebrew, and she had learned some of the legalities of Judaism, but she hadn't learned creation and Adam and Eve and the fall and God's plan of redemption and all these things. So when they got through the gospel and they talked about Jesus and his death and how to be saved, Pastor Derek said to Sarah, would you like Jesus to come into your life and save you? And she stopped and she looked at him and she said, are you telling me that Jesus wants to save me no matter what I've done? And do you know where I work? And do you know the life that I've lived? And do you know what I've done? And Derek said, that's why Jesus died for you. And she broke and just wept. I mean, she fell apart. She said, I can't believe he wants me. And not a few minutes later, she bowed her head and she trusted Christ as her Savior. She went through discipleship. She got baptized shortly thereafter. She went through discipleship. She has grown and grown and grown. And she has witness to every family member. She's witness to every friend. She showed up 2 months later with a young lady that was a friend of hers that was a prostitute. That girl trusted Christ as her Savior. She had been a drug addict since she was 13. She told me and my wife, I've been sex trafficked since I was 13 here in Hartford. And she actually passed away about a month later. She got sick. It was a drug-related thing. She got an infection, and she died. But Sarah has been growing, growing, growing. She sings in the choir. We have sometimes an ensemble that helps lead our congregational singing. And she sings, we call it the front line. She sings on the front line now. She has read every Christian book that I will give her, and some that I wish she hadn't read. She started reading a lot of books by Calvinists. And I said, hey, I know you're going to learn some stuff, but let me give you some other ones because I don't want you to become a Calvinist. I said, you know, they wouldn't have even maybe led you to Christ, so maybe you got to balance this out. But growing and hungry, well, the lady I got a text from, the text that I got tonight is from, let me read the name again. This is Deanna Spiziel. She said, I want to get baptized on Sunday, this Sunday. This is a friend of Sarah's. And it's the first lady that Sarah led to Christ. Sarah texted me a month ago and said, I just led one of my friends to Christ. I'm telling you guys. All that to say, God's working in New England where people say it can't be done. Our church is full of new believers. And I think we have a good number of people planning to be baptized on Sunday. So you pray for us. We're really excited about what God has done. And I'm so thankful that I can share God's word with you tonight. Go to 1 Chronicles chapter 19. And I want to The title of this message is Behaving Valiantly. And I have really asked God to guide my words that I might challenge you. And here's what I want to do is I want to look at the scripture. I want to tell you the story. I want to point out the verse, the center verse that I want to focus on. And then I want to tell you how God used this verse to break me. And I pray that it will challenge you as well. So let me pray, and then we'll jump into scripture. Lord, I love you, and I thank you for the privilege to preach to these men tonight. I thank you for the churches that are represented. I pray that you would challenge us as men tonight and in the morning and grow us in your grace and mature us and change us and help us to realize we have a calling from you as men to take up our roles, to take up our leadership, to take up our assignments, to love like you love, to lead like you lead, to help others to know you. And God, we sometimes feel so fearful against the tasks you've given to us and so insufficient and inadequate in and of ourselves. But you are sufficient, and you enable us in the ways that you call us. And so, God, I pray that you would guide my words tonight, enable me, and most of all, use your word to stir our hearts and to challenge us together as men. Give us tender hearts and responsive hearts, and guide my words. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Look at 1 Chronicles 19. Now, it came to pass after this that Nahash, the king of the children of Ammon, died, and his son reigned in his stead. Nahash was the son of a man that had been kind to David. David is now king. The children of Ammon are descendants of Lot and his relationship with one of his daughters. And they are their homeland is east of Israel. And they're the enemies of Israel. Verse 2, and David said, I will show kindness unto Hanan, the son of Nahash, because his father showed kindness to me. And David sent messengers to comfort him concerning his father. So the servants of David came into the land of the children of Ammon to Hanan to comfort him. So you got to get the background here. David has no ill will towards Hanan. He actually is trying to comfort him because his dad died, and his dad was kind to him at some point, probably when he was struggling with Saul. And so he sends messengers. Well, verse 3, Hanan totally misunderstands David's motives, and he really creates a problem here. But the princes of the children of Ammon said to Hanan, thinkest thou that David doth honor thy father, that he hath sent comforters unto thee? Are not his servants come unto thee for to search and to overthrow and to spy out the land? Really bad advice. Okay. Verse 4, where this is all background, by the way. There's a lot we could comment about all this. There's so many great things here, but we're going to work down to a particular verse I want to focus on. Verse 4, wherefore Hanan took David's servants and shaved them and cut off their garments in the midst, hard by their buttocks, and sent them away. So he shaved their beards, cut their armor and their clothing off literally from the waist down, and sent them away. It was a way that they would publicly shame these that had come from Israel. I mean, imagine these messengers with nothing but comfort and, you know, blessing. They have no ill will. Suddenly they're shaved and they're stripped and sent away, humiliated. Strange. Verse 5, then there went certain and told David how the men were served. And he sent to meet them, for the men were greatly ashamed. And the king said, tarry at Jericho until your beards be grown, and then return. And when the children of Ammon saw that they had made themselves odious to David, Hanan and the children of Ammon sent 1,000 talents of silver to hire them chariots and horsemen out of Mesopotamia and out of Syria-Maka and out of Zobah. So, to make matters worse, in verse 6, instead of just apologizing, asking forgiveness, you know, trying to reconcile and make the situation right, they're thinking, okay, we've blown it. We're going to anger David and Israel. Now they're going to come against us. We better armor up. We better hire mercenaries. So they send money north out of Syria. They hire Syrians to come to their defense. Verse 7, so they hired 30 and 2,000 chariots. Can you imagine? 32,000 chariots. This is a massive force. And the king of Makkah and his people, who came and pitched before Medeba, and the children of Ammon gathered themselves together from their cities and came to battle. So now you have two forces coming together, really for no good reason. It's strange. This shouldn't even be happening right now. This is a contrived battle, a contrived war. David didn't want war with these people. But now there's two massive forces kind of converging from two different directions. Verse 8, and when David heard of it, he sent Joab and all the hosts of the mighty men. And the children of Ammon came out and put the battle in array before the gate of the city. And the kings that were come were by themselves in the field. Now when Joab, here it is, listen, when Joab saw that the battle was set against him before and behind, he chose out all the choice of Israel and put them in array against the Syrians. And the rest of the people he delivered under the hand of Abishai, his brother, and they set themselves in array against the children of Ammon. And he said, if the Syrians be too strong for me, then thou shalt help me. But if the children of Ammon be too strong for thee, then I will help thee. So Joab sends Abishai, splits his forces, and he basically says, you take these people, and you go that way, and you go fight that direction, and I'll take this force, and I'll go this way and fight. And if I need your help, you come help me, and if you need my help, I'll come help you. Now, I want you to read verse 13, okay? Out loud, verse 13, all of it, ready, go. Be of good courage, and let us behave ourselves valiantly for our people and for the cities of our God. And let the Lord do that which is good in his sight. Now look at this verse again. Let me just read it slowly. I want you to think about it. Be of good courage. And let us behave ourselves valiantly for our people and for the cities of our God. And let the Lord do that which is good in his sight. Have you ever been tempted to do the cowardly thing? Have you ever been facing circumstances, decisions, situations where the easy way out, the safe way out, the less risky way out, the easy path was screaming at you, do this, do the cowardly thing instead of the fearful thing? Have you ever faced a situation or circumstance where the right thing was the hard thing? The right thing was the risky thing. The right thing was the costly thing. Have you ever been called of God to step into the face of something that was staring you down and tempted to be fearful or tempted to do something less than valiant? Years ago, Dana and I, we decided to take a family walk. This was a beautiful afternoon. It was spring. The weather had started to get better. We lived in Southern California up in the high desert. It had been cool, relatively cool, but now coming into March, April, the weather was getting better. They had opened a Walmart about a mile and a half from our house. And I said to Dana, let's put Haley in her little wagon. She was a little girl at the time. I forgot to tell you, I have a third child. Her name's Haley. She's 19 and she's at college right now. But we put her in her little wagon, and I said, let's get the boys. They can ride their bikes, and let's just go out for a walk. And so we started taking this walk, and we got right around the corner from our house, and we started talking about family vacation coming up in a few months. We hadn't formalized our plans, and I had an idea about vacation, and my wife had an idea about vacation, and we didn't realize that our ideas conflicted. Now, maybe this never happens to you, okay? But suddenly, we're in this moment where this walk starts to go, the conversation, which should have been fun, we were going to go get ice cream or, you know, Slurpee or whatever at Walmart, and just a few steps out our front door, suddenly the conversation is growing tense because She wants to go to Northern California and visit her family for vacation, and I want to go somewhere alone with our family for vacation. And I got great ideas, and she's got great ideas, but of course my ideas are better than hers, right? I mean, my idea for vacation is going to be fun, and her idea is stupid. And I'm trying to tell her, you know, your idea is stupid. And the more I'm standing there trying to sell my idea, the more frustrated she's getting at me, and the more frustrated she's getting, the more frustrated I'm getting. And I'm pushing for my way and pulling for my way, and she's pulling for her way. Pretty soon we're in this kind of this tug of war, this standoff, and then it gets a little tense, and then we get a little more irritated with each other. Pretty soon we're in this discussion, you know. Now, Haley's in a wagon, and I'm pulling her. The boys are riding their bikes kind of in circles. They'll go about 20, 30, 40 yards out in front of us, and they'll say, hey, boys, turn around and come back. And then they'll come back and go 30, 40 yards that way, and then they'll circle and come, and they're doing that. So they're not hearing our argument. We didn't really ever argue in front of our kids. But we're trying not to be demonstrative. We're trying not to raise our voices, but it's tense. You know, we're having this back and forth, and it's tense. And then what's weird is we live in this neighborhood with other church families, and they keep driving by. It's like, we're talking. You know how that goes. You're waving like everything's good. Once they get outside, you know, we're right back at it. And I'm trying to convince her, and she's trying to convince me, and we're oblivious to what's about to happen. We rounded a corner, and about maybe 50 or 60 yards down the street, two pit bulls are barreling towards us. And at this time in our area, pit bulls, there was some gang activity, and pit bulls were like this trendy thing for the gangbangers to have. And literally, they would just put them on these chains, and they'd walk around with them almost like, you know, don't mess with me. And there were stories of kids getting mauled in the news, and people that had been hurt by dogs and stuff like that. So we were all of a sudden, you know, on high alert. I mean, every nerve in our minds and bodies on high alert, and these pit bulls are coming at us. And all of a sudden, by the way, nothing that we were arguing about even mattered anymore. Because really, my boys are on bikes about 20 yards out in front of me. I got a little girl in a wagon behind me and my wife, and I got two pit bulls chasing and running down towards us. And these pit bulls are hungry. How do you know? I can tell. They got napkins tied around their neck. They got steak sauce in their back pocket. They're hungry, okay? And I, you know, so I'm ready. I'm thinking, I don't even know what to do, to be honest with you, because I don't think we can run. They're coming on us fast. My boys, this is really funny. My boys saw them. They're on bikes. I don't know why they did this. They ditched their bikes, and they ran. They jumped off their bikes and started running this way. I'm kind of freezing, like, what do I do? I'm thinking the boys are running that way, and pretty soon they're behind me. The pit bulls are coming. Haley is behind me in the wagon, and Dana's next to me, and I'm kind of like, okay, what do I do? I'm thinking, okay, the family can run, but Haley can't run, and I'm going to be slow carrying Haley. They're just going to catch up to me. So literally, the only thing I could think to do is grab my daughter and let my wife and sons run and lift my daughter up into the air and stand there, okay, with my eyes closed. Like, okay, just prepared to be, you know, from here down, mauled, okay? It's an act of self-sacrifice. I'm like, take me, just not my daughter, you know, and I'm expecting Dana and the boys to run. This is all happening so fast. The adrenaline, and I mean, all, you know, it's a tense moment. The owner of the pit bulls is about 20 or 30 yards behind them, running that direction, trying to catch the dogs. So here we go. I lift Haley up, just instinctively, trying to get her up higher than the dogs. And I'm thinking, and I'm literally like gritting my teeth because they're coming at me. And I'm thinking my wife and boys are now running that way real fast. And the next thing that happened, I will never forget in my life. Dana had watched a documentary on Discover or National Geographic or sometime on TV, she had learned what to do if you're ever confronted by a pit bull. Now, does anybody in the room, you probably all know what to do, when confronted by a pit bull? 9mm would work. That would work. We didn't happen to have one on us at the time. That would have been nice. So I'm standing there with Haley, and I'm just kind of squinting, ready. I'm literally ready to kick these dogs, but I'm thinking I'm probably going to lose. I'm gonna scrap them, but I'm probably going to lose. And Dana's kind of behind me, but I think she's running, but she's not. She's standing right behind me. And these pit bulls get about 10, maybe 5 or 10 yards in front of us. And what happens next? My wife doesn't even like me to tell this story because she's petite, she's quiet, she's meek-spirited. She's not a, you know, get out in front of people, make a bunch of noise. She's not an attention-grabbing person. She just likes to kind of be in the background. But I will imitate for you what my wife did. Okay, and this is no exaggeration. So the pit bulls are there, napkins, steak, sauce, you know, knife and fork, they're ready to go. I'm holding Haley, and my wife jumps in front of me. You guys want me to stop preaching right now, don't you? My wife jumps in front of me. That's all I need to say. She does this. And she starts growling and barking and screaming at these dogs. And I'm standing there, having just had an argument with her, holding my daughter, and I'm watching this out of one eye, like, what is she doing? And as soon as she jumped in front of me and got down and literally, like, bared her fangs and her claws and started growling and screaming and barking at those dogs, their eyes, I kid you not, got as big as half dollars. And they started backpedaling with their front paws, and they quickly turned around and literally ran the opposite way as fast as they could. Now, when she did this, the owner of the dogs was approaching, you know, maybe 30 or 40 yards away, and saw my wife do this and start screaming at my wife. And she said, "Hey, you're scaring my dogs!" And my wife, who has gone nuclear on the pit bulls, stays in pit bull mode and goes nuclear on the neighbor who's chasing the dogs. And she says, "Oh, yeah, your dogs, I'm going to take my kids, and I'll kill your dogs." And I'm standing there with just holding my daughter up in the air, and I'm looking at all this. And then the dogs ran back. The lady turned around, took her dogs back. My wife, she's breathless, and she stops, and she turns around, and she sees me. And I'm standing there holding Haley up, and I'm like, "We can go wherever you want to go on vacation." I don't want her to do that to me. From that day forward, I don't mess with my wife. I don't mess. Now, all kidding aside, I tease about that story because I'm thinking, you know, I'm the assistant pastor of the church down the street. The neighbors were looking out the window going, "Yeah, that guy's a music director. His wife just saved him from the pit bulls." You know, they're putting it all together. And they're seeing that I apparently didn't do the courageous thing. I looked at her, though. She kind of straightens her clothes off. She dusts herself off. She goes back and stands next to me. And I'm like, well, she's like nothing happened. And I go, "What was that?" She goes, "That's what you're supposed to do if you get run down by a pit bull." Like, how in the world did you know that? She said, "Oh, I saw it on television. I saw it on Discovery Channel." I'm like, "Well, it would have been good to know." I said, "I thought you were running, and I'm trying to hold Haley and keep her safe, and the boys are running, and here you are, saved our lives." Listen. The truth is, valiant behavior is literally to jump into the fray of God's calling on your life for those he's placed in your life. Valiant behavior is something that is, in my opinion, tragically missing in our culture among men. Valiant behavior, valor, courage in the face of all the onslaught that's coming our way. And I got to tell you guys, when it comes to my call to Connecticut, when it comes to my call to be a senior pastor, to go to a dying church, it was terrifying. It was to me more terrifying than that pit bull experience was to my boys. It was something that to me seemed so far above me and beyond me. Frankly, having a wife and having children and being called to lead like Jesus, to love my wife like Jesus loves her, and to lead my children like Jesus would lead them, and to train them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. The call to lead a church, the call to lead anything, and by the way, we're all called to lead something as men. We're all called to behave valiantly. We're called to step in and make a difference as men. It is built in to our role, to our assignment. It is a part of the unique call of God on our lives. And we live in a nation that's suffering for a lack of courageous and valiant leadership. And we live in a world where families, literally wives and children and churches, church bodies, are desperate for men who will behave valiantly, not brutishly, not arrogantly, but to come out of that passive disengagement, to come out of that fear or that cowardice, and to literally put yourself in the face of danger, to take the risk, to do the hard thing, to follow the call of God, to step in where you feel insufficient, or where you feel weak, or where you feel afraid, or where you feel that you're not up to the task. So, what does this behavior look like? That's the question I want to put before us tonight. What does valiant behavior look like? Because 1 Chronicles 19:13, look at the middle of this verse. He says, "Be of good courage, let us behave ourselves." What's the word? Valiantly. Let us behave ourselves valiantly. So I'm going to give you a statement, and then I want to unpack this with you for the rest of our time and tell you how God broke me with this verse. Valiant behavior, if you're taking notes, here it is. It does the right thing for the right reasons at the right time with courage and compassion. Valiant, I'm going to say that a couple more times. Valiant behavior does the right thing for the right reasons, at the right time, with courage and compassion. One more time. It does the right thing for the right reasons, at the right time, with courage and compassion. I want to lift off three principles from this verse, and I want you to see them, and then I want to tell you how God used these to just literally flatten me. Okay? First thought, valiant behavior is courageous in the face of fear. It is courageous in the face of fear. All throughout Scripture, and by the way, the time that God used this the most powerfully in my life was as He was unfolding this call. And one thing I can tell you, if you journey from Genesis until 1 Chronicles 19 in your Old Testament Scripture reading, you're going to continually come across the words courage and strong over and over and over again. You can pick the person, you can pick the time, you can pick the circumstances, but over and over, God comes to His men that He has appointed, that He's assigned, that He's placed very strategically, and He tells them, be strong, be of good courage. Joshua, Moses, on and on I could go. Be strong, be of good courage, be courageous. I am with you. Now, by the way, courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is not the absence of hesitation. Courage is the recognition that God is bigger than my fear and that His enabling power and presence is with me in the call. And courage says, I'm going to lean into my fear. I am going to go forward through that fear. Yeah, I feel it. Yeah, it's big. Yeah, it's powerful. Some of the assignments that God gives to us, guys, they're terrifying unless you're just oblivious and presumptuous and self-filled, self-confident. If you look at what God gives you to do and you have a real accurate estimation of yourself, He's going to bring you into callings and assignments that are bigger than you. And that's on purpose. That's what He does, okay? He takes regular broken men and brings them to Himself and then brings them into His assignments, and His assignments are always scary. They're always intimidating. They always require faith and trust that always will engender fear or stir up fear. And over God says, be strong, but not this fake contrived strength, not a presumptuous, I got this kind of strength, not a self-confident strength, but a deep strength that says, I don't have this, but he does. And I don't have any confidence in me or in my flesh, but I have confidence in my God. And I know that this is his assignment. And I know that he is with me. And so I am going to let him fight for me. I'm going to walk around these walls until they fall. I'm not giving up. I'm going to engage. I'm going to do what he's told me to do because I know he's with me. And he promises me his strength. And he tells me that I can be courageous. So God says over and over, stop being afraid. Stop wimping out. Choose a different behavior. What began with Adam continues to this day. And I want to get a little personal here. Every one of us in this room are tempted to cowardice. Every one of us in this room, and I'm not, maybe you're tough. Maybe you'll fight somebody. Maybe you're good with guns. Maybe you're great at hunting or fishing. Maybe you're great at sports or football. Maybe you've got all the masculinity that any man ever had. That's not what I'm talking about. Okay? What I'm talking about is Adam's silence when Eve was being tempted. What I'm talking about is God says that, the Bible, the account says Eve gave to Adam who was there with her. The sense of it is he was there and he did not intervene. He was there and did nothing to defend her, did nothing to stand up for her and to protect her. And his passivity and his cowardice and his silence, his disengagement, it was cowardly. It was the opposite of valiant behavior. And I would say most men prefer the path of least resistance. Most men are lazy by nature. And I'm not talking about maybe you're a hard worker. I'm talking about lazy spiritually, lazy relationally. We are selfish by nature. We prefer not to engage in the resistance of the spiritual forces that come against our family. Often we prefer not to engage in the aspects of leadership that are the most difficult or the most intimidating. I know a lot of men who work really hard to provide materially for their family, but they're neglecting the relationships. And they're not teaching the Word of God. They're not cultivating the hearts. I know a lot of men that will teach their kids how to throw a football or shoot a deer or gut an antelope, but they won't pray with them before they go to bed. The same guy who's got the courage to pull a trigger doesn't have the courage to teach spiritual things or to lead spiritually. I know pastors that don't want to deal with sticky situations. They won't lovingly enter into confrontation. I know husbands who won't sit up and work through something in humility with his wife. He's got to be defensive. He's got to be caustic. He's got to walk out and slam the door and drive away. He's got to do anything but engage in the hard stuff. Okay? And that's the kind of cowardice I'm talking about. It's disengagement. And yet the Word of God instructs us to the opposite. The Word of God says, step forward into God's assignment for you. Step forward into the hard stuff. Step forward into the valuable stuff, into the spiritual stuff. Be of good courage. Be willing to intervene. Be willing to lead well. Be willing to grow in spiritual and emotional maturity so that you can lead in all the areas of life that are difficult and that are oppressive to your family and to those you love. We are called to care. We're called to confront. We're called to know the way and go the way and show the way. We're called to lead those that we love. Like Joab and Abishai, God will routinely bring men, bring you and me, into fearful situations that require courage. I don't understand it. Dana and I, we were newlyweds. And we were still in Bible college. We had one semester left of Bible college. We got invited to go to a church about 3 or 4 hours away to do weekend ministry. They put us up in a really cheap motel. And so we got into our room that night. We were getting ready for bed. I noticed when I walked into the room, there was this guy down at the end of the sidewalk smoking a cigarette, just kind of hanging out. It was weird to me. And I just kind of took notice of that. Young man, I'm a young man. I got a new bride. I'm on alert for her safety. I also noticed when I got into the room that the window had a mini blind that you could twist and close the blinds. But I noticed that one of those blinds was bent. It was back when they were made out of that aluminum, thin aluminum. And once they got bent, they were always bent. And I noticed that one of those blinds was bent, so it just created this little gap in the blinds, like about that big. And I just happened to note, well, the lights are on in this room. It's dark out there. Man, if anybody wanted to look through that window, that would be a good place to look through, you know. And there's no way I can cover that up. So I had gotten into a pair of gym shorts, and I was sitting in bed, and Dana was in the restroom getting ready for bed. And I'm sitting there reading, waiting for her, and I thought of that little gap in those blinds. And I real quickly turned to the right, and what I saw next lit something on fire inside of me. I saw the reflection off the guy's glasses up against the window. I saw that thick black rim of his glasses looking through that little gap in the hotel, in the blinds. Well, Dana, we were dressed appropriately, but she walked out of the bathroom right as I saw this guy looking in the window. And without even thinking, I threw the cover back, bounded out of bed. I ran over to the window, and I yelled at the top of my lungs. It was purely instinctive, differently than the pit bull situation. I bounded out of bed. I threw the blinds up. I said, "Hey, you jerk!" And I started yelling at the guy. And when I threw the blinds up, he ducked down, and he scurried down the sidewalk. Well, I ran, and Dana said, "What are you doing?" I ran over to the door, threw the door open, and started chasing the guy down the sidewalk. I got about 20, he ran out into the darkness, out in the back of the parking lot, and I got about 20 yards down the sidewalk and realized, like, I'm out here with bare feet, gym, like boxer shorts, nothing else. I'm like, and Dana's standing at the door looking out, like, what in the world is going on? And I realized, I'm not going to catch the guy. It would kind of be like the dog that caught the car. Like, what am I going to do with him if I catch him, you know? So I walked back to the room, and she said, "What in the world?" I said, "There was a dude looking in the window." Well, of course, now she got creeped out. We shut the door. We're trying to get in bed. We got towels. We put them all over the windows. We tried to do everything we could. We tried to lay there in bed. For 2 hours, we could not sleep. We got up. We checked out of the hotel. We went to another one, and we finally got some sleep. But in that moment, there was something in me that desperately wanted to protect and fight for my family. Now, here's where I was going with that story. Why will my heart do that to protect physically, to stand in the gap physically? But it's so easy to do that, but it's so hard to pray with my wife. I mean, I'll fight for her tomorrow. I'll die for her tomorrow. But praying with her before bed is hard. I don't understand why. But I think it has something to do with the spiritual value of my call as a spiritual leader and the significance of me getting active spiritually and behaving valiantly in her life to lead her, to love her spiritually. Satan doesn't want me to do that. He doesn't want me. And so the intimidation factor is so powerful in some of these areas of our lives. And we're tempted to be cowardly. We're tempted to do the fearful thing or to do the easy thing and to take the low road. And in the meanwhile, those that we love, those that we lead, they suffer for it. Because we're not willing to do the hard thing. Everybody else has to deal with the discomfort of our absence or our neglect or our passivity or our unwillingness to resolve or to work through things or to build healthy relationships. So, valiant behavior is courageous in the face of fear. Number two, you still with me? Okay. See, courageous in the face of fear, the scripture says it. He says in verse 13, be of good courage. Be of good courage. Okay. Number two, it is compassionate for the good of others. Look at verse 13 again. Be of good courage. Let us behave ourselves valiantly. What are the next three words? For our people. Look at this, though. And for the what? Cities of our God. See, it's not about you. It's not about me. It's about the people God's given us to love. God says, do what is best for everybody involved. There are cities where I want to work. There are people in your care. There are people within the sphere of your influence. There are people in proximity to you who have to live with the results of your leadership. There are people that God has assigned to your care, to your environments, your home, your business, your church, your community, your neighborhood. There are people that God's placed in proximity to you, and He's placed you in proximity to them, and He's given you a role in their lives. And it is, in part, to provide and to protect materially and physically. But it is also to provide spiritually and emotionally and relationally. It is a comprehensive call. And He calls you to be the man, to show thyself a man. He places you in these situations, much like this battle, where there's enemies on both sides. And you're the strategic general that's got to behave valiantly for the good of others. Now, just very quickly, most men generally do what's best for themselves and for their own passions or for their own advancement or their own self-interest. Guys, it's just in us. We just generally look for our own comfort. But God has put you where you are with the people He's given to you. He's given you a heart to love and a body to express that love with. And He calls you to step up in those hard moments and do what is best for others. Like Joab and Abishai, God routinely brings men to decision points. Here it is, that immeasurably impact the lives of others. It's staggering to me to think about, I ask myself this all the time, what's it like to be married to me? What's it like to be fathered by me? What's it like to be pastored by me? What's it like to be led by me? Are people the victims of my leadership? Or are they blessed by it? Are the people in my care, are the people in proximity to me, are they flourishing under my leadership? Are they healthy? Are they... I'm not just talking about physically healthy. I'm talking about soul health. Are they spiritually growing and thriving? Does my leadership create environments in my home, in my workplace, in my church? When I walk into the room, does it make the room a more flourishing place? Or do people tense up, wonder which version of me they're going to get? Do my kids wonder if I'm going to come unglued, lose my cool? Or are they glad to see me? You see, they're not the problem, I am. I don't have time to tell you the story, but as a young married man, I didn't know how to be a husband. And I wasn't being a very good one. And there came a moment where I realized that I was hurting my wife, and I was being neglectful. I was working way too much in the ministry, and I was being neglectful of her and my two young boys before my daughter was born. And for several months, I was resisting the conviction of God and her prodding. And she was trying to tell me she wasn't getting what she needed from me in terms of time and attention and focus. And the boys weren't getting what they needed from me. And I was taking all that with a defensive posture. I was acting like she was the problem. She was too needy. That was my phrase. Which I don't want to rabbit trail. But guys, yeah, they're needy. So are you. I mean, every time I sit down with a husband and wife that are having problems, inevitably, I could bet money on it, the guy's going to say at some point in the conversation, she's just so needy. And I want to go, you know what, I used to be a jerk too. Like one day God said to me, of course she's needy, that's why I gave her to you. What did you want? I mean, you could have married a bowling ball, they're less needy. Telephone poles, they're less needy. But you married a woman and you have children and they're needy. And God's given you exactly what they need. But Satan wants to take you out of the picture. And he'll do that in any variety of ways. He wants to remove you from the picture. And I just remember looking into Dana's face one day and realizing there's pain there. And the Spirit of God, I don't know if he does this to you like he does it with me, but oh my goodness, these are painful conversations. He just camped out in the back of my head and said, look at the pain you're creating. Do you see that? That's pain. And this is my daughter, and I gave her to you. And she was happy when I gave her to you. That's what the Spirit of God said to me. And he said, and I'm holding you accountable for this, pal. And boy, I tell you what, it broke me. And I got along with God, and I got on my face and said, God, I'm sorry. I have not been taking care of her or my boys. And I went back and sat down with Dana, and I apologized, and I asked her forgiveness. Our oldest son was about 5 at the time. I think that afternoon saved our marriage. But it wasn't my wife that needed to change. It was me. And it was my cowardice that needed to go away. I needed to be valiant. And you know what valor was? Repentance. That's valiant. You know what courage was in the moment? Admitting that I was wrong. Admitting that I was proud. Admitting that I was neglectful and arrogant and defensive. Admitting that I was a jerk. Boy, it was painful. But it brought peace and it brought unity and joy back to our family. God's put you into the lives of people, and your leadership affects those people. And valiant leadership says, I'm going to give myself to blessing these people and to caring for them and giving them an environment where they can flourish in health and where I can meet their spiritual, emotional, physical, relational needs, all of these needs. I want to be a part of meeting these needs the way God calls me to. Valiant behavior does the right thing for the right reasons at the right time with courage and compassion. So, first thought. It's courageous in the face of fear. Number 2, it's compassionate for the good of others. Number 3, and this is, I think, the best, for me, it's the best part. It's confident in obedience to God. It's confident in obedience to God. Now, I already talked about this fake, presumptuous, kind of self-filled self-confidence. Like, I've got this, okay? I know what I'm doing. Get out of my way. That's not what I'm talking about, okay? What I'm talking about is what God gives you when you understand who He is and who you are and what He's called you to do, and you accept it. You accept your assignment, even though you don't feel up to it, even though you might not feel equipped for it. You might not even know how to do it. The day I talked to Dana and I repented and I said, you know what? I know, here's what I said to her. I know that I'm not a good husband. In fact, I don't know even how to be a good husband. When I married you, I thought, I got this. And now for 5 years, God's shown me, I don't got this. And I don't even know how. I don't even know what I'm doing. Even when I said that to her, hope came back into her face and her heart. It was like, oh, thank you, Lord. He knows what a loser he is. And I said this, but I promise you today, I'm not going anywhere, and I want to become the husband you need. And I promise you today, I'm going to stop invalidating your needs, and I'm going to start trying to understand them. I'm going to stop dismissing them, and I'm going to start affirming them. I'm going to start meeting them. And I don't even know what to do, but I know God has placed me in this assignment. He has given me this role. And though I don't know how to do it, He will help me and He will enable me. And I want you to see the verse. Verse 13 again. Be of good courage. There's courageous. Courage. Next, let us behave ourselves valiantly for our people and for the cities of our God. And, here it is, let the Lord do. Now, you tell me, guys, who is the active, like, operator in that statement? The Lord, right? See, Joab and Abishai had this sense. We are pieces in the puzzle. We are leaders that God has placed by His providence in these positions. We're generals amongst God's people, but this is really the Lord. This is the Lord's battle. This is the Lord's work. These are the Lord's people. These are God's cities. Are you tracking with me? You see, they knew their place, and they knew this was really God's thing, okay? And they basically said, hey, let's kind of give ourselves to whatever God wants to do, but it's Him that's doing it. So, yeah, we're going to fight. Yeah, we're going to engage. Yeah, we're going to kind of go at this thing with the best of our abilities, but really we realize underneath it all, it's really the Lord doing it. And you know what they're saying? We might win or lose, but we're going to give it our best. We're going to behave valiantly, and we're going to let God, we're going to obey God, and we're going to leave the outcomes to Him. I want you to, this is a little bit of a rabbit trail sidebar, but I want you to write this down. Success is obedience. And obedience is success. Success is obedience, and obedience is success. If you are living a life to the best of your understanding, in obedience to your God, you are a success. I don't care what you make. I don't care what the size of your retirement account is. I don't care how materially or academically or socioeconomically successful you are in the world's eyes. If you are on mission with your God, if you are fulfilling His assignments that He has given you, if you are living in obedience to Him, then you are a success. And you don't have to compare with anybody or compete with anybody. You don't have to be anybody else. You have to be who God made you to be. You have to wake up every day living with the knowledge that I am obeying my God. Doesn't matter who in hair lips. Doesn't matter who accepts me or rejects me. I belong to God. I'm obeying Him. Success. And He can do whatever He wants with my life. Let the Lord do that which is good in His sight. Now, valiant behavior, here it is courageous in the face of fear, compassionate for the good of others, and confident in obedience to God. This kind of leadership gets out of God's way. This kind of leadership stops preventing God from whatever He wants to do. In your life, in your family, in your church, it gets out of the way of His moving. It engages in His call and His assignments. It leaves it all on the field. It takes the risks He says to take. It lunges out, leaps out in faith that He calls you to step out into. It does what you know God wants you to do no matter the cost. And it leaves the outcomes to Him because it is confident in Him. This kind of leadership is willing to lay it all on the line when God says lay it all on the line in honor to God, knowing that God is going to come through. And it lets God do whatever God wants to do. Here's another statement I'd like you to write down if you're taking notes. The price of disobedience is always higher than the price of obedience. Now let me tell you the story behind all this for me, okay? It's a little bit when I told you on my call. Right after my cancer diagnosis, maybe 6 months. So I got done with my last treatment in July of 2011. By November of 2011, just starting to get my strength back and muscle mass, and just starting to feel even, it was a long road back to normal, but starting to see that road come into view. And God started keeping me awake every single night. I was getting just very little sleep. I was tossing and turning and wrestling with God. There was a deep sense of unrest that I knew was spiritual in nature. I didn't know if it was a midlife crisis or some, but God was stirring something in my life that I didn't understand. November, December, January, February, March, this only intensified. And it was almost like living in a fun house, a fun house of mirrors. No matter where I looked, no matter where I went, no matter what scripture I read, no matter what church service I sat in, who I heard preach the Bible or teach the Bible, everywhere I looked, I was hearing the same thing. God was saying, follow me. Walk away. Leave it all. I'm calling you away. Your assignment here is done. I mean, every which way I turned, every song, every prayer, it was everywhere, and I couldn't get away from it. No matter where I turned, it was always the voice of God stirring and calling and compelling. And I got to tell you guys, November, December, January, February, March, I'm fighting God. I'm pushing Him back. I'm like, God, this is too much of a cost. I've been here 22 years. There's too many people that I love here. There's too many long life, deep relationships and growing up together. And I've never had a plan B. I can't imagine myself anywhere else. 22 years of hard work. And I finally have a nice house. And my kids are coming into their teenage and college years. And things are good. And in the back of my mind, I'm going, I've worked hard for this. And God's saying, yeah, now give it all back. You've got to be kidding me. And it was, if you understand the California real estate market, it goes way up and then it goes way down. And we bought a house. We put all of our equity into this house. It was a little bigger house because we had large groups that came to the house a lot. That was the only reason we got a bigger house was we had youth group and college age and singles and all these people over our house all the time. It was kind of interesting. Guys, I'd walk into that house. We only lived in it for 6 years. We bought it at a midpoint. It spiked in value, and then it plummeted in value. So we bought a house that we owed like $270 on, and then it went up to like $500,000 in value. And I'm like, yes, this is great. Retirement is set. And then it plunged, and it was worth like $150,000. Brand new construction. But it didn't matter to me because I'm gonna die in this house. And every day I walk into the house, I close the door when I get back home every day, and I call out to my wife, Dana, just, hey, I'm upstairs. I say, I love this house. I'm going to die in this house. And one day God said, walk away. And I'm like, from this house? And God said, yes. But at the time He said to walk away, the house was worth $150,000 and I owed $270,000. And I'm like, God, you got to wait for the market to come back. And I'm negotiating. I'm telling God all the reasons I can't obey Him. I can't uproot my wife. I can't uproot my kids, all their friends, all their life, everything they know, everyone I know. It's all here. All of my retirement value is sunken into this house and plunged down. We've lost it all, but it's going to come back. It will come back. It did come back 3 years after I left the house. And I'm telling you, for 4 months, I questioned and argued and vetted. I mean, part of my heart was clarification, God. Give me clarification. Give me clarification. I don't want to get this wrong. But part of my heart was, please, God, change your mind. This is terrifying. This is scary. I don't want to do this. The price is too high. Mid-March, I got up. One morning, I was getting ready for work, and Dana was getting ready, and I looked at her. She knew I had stewed and tossed and turned and walked the house all night. And I looked at her, and I said, what is God doing to me? Like I didn't already know. But this is what we do. We negotiate. We argue with God instead of being valiant. I was playing the coward. I'd worked hard. I deserved all this. God, look how hard I've worked. Your blessings are good, you know. Why do I want to walk away from all this? Plus, we were in a good church, a good ministry. We had good opportunities in that ministry. And God's saying, walk away. It just didn't make sense. God, why would you ask me to do this? When I said to Dana, what is God doing to me? She came back at me with a statement that I'll never forget. She said, very soberly, she said, do you really want to know what I think? Now, that's totally unlike her. Okay, I, number one, didn't know she had an opinion. I should have known. But it struck me the way she said it. Like, do you really want to know what I think? And I go, I'm like, in the back of my mind, I'm like, I don't think I do. I said, okay, yeah. She said, okay. She said, I need to tell you, I don't want to go anywhere. She said, I love our life, and I have no desire. I love this house. I love where we live. I love everything about our lives. I have no desire for any of this. And she said, that's why I haven't said anything to you about what God's telling me, because I don't want to sway or influence you in what God's doing with you. Now I'm like, but she said, 2 years ago, God told me to hold loosely to our material world, especially to the house. And I'm shocked that she says this. She said, 2 years ago, God told me he was going to be doing something in your life, and I needed to prepare for it. And she said, well, a year and a half now, you got cancer. And at first, I thought, well, this is what God's been telling me to get ready for. And she was such a spiritual friend and strength through that whole cancer journey. But maybe share a little of that with you tomorrow. But she said, but then cancer, God cured you and you got better, and you're still struggling and wrestling with God. So now I think that cancer was only the thing that God used to get you ready for what's next. And I'm listening with rapt attention now. And she said, I think God's calling you to pastor a church, but I think you're afraid. Okay, now she's going to preach to me in about 60 seconds the most powerful sermon anybody's ever preached to me. Okay, she nailed me to the wall with absolute precision. She said, I think you're afraid because you don't think you can do it. Well, she was absolutely right. Okay, and she said, so, number one, point one, she didn't say it that way, but she said, number one, if God's calling you, Cary, you can't reason through it. You have to surrender to it because it doesn't go away. Okay, now I'm just emotionally flattened. I can't believe this is coming out of my wife's mouth. She said, secondly, I think you're using me as an excuse because you don't want to uproot me. But what you need to know is I surrendered my will to God 2 years ago. And I surrendered this house and all of our lives and my everything that's valuable to me, I surrendered to God for whatever he wants to do with you. So I'm already surrendered. I'm ready to go wherever God leads you to go. I mean, it's nuclear bomb after nuclear bomb. She said, thirdly, I think you're using our kids as an excuse. You're reasoning with God that you can't uproot the kids, and Haley's going into junior high, and it's a bad time, and all this, and they're going to have a hard time with it. And she said, Cary, all I know is God loves our kids more than we love our kids. So I think they'll be okay. And she said, fourthly, she said, I think, again, that you're afraid, and you think you can't do it. But then she looked at me, and she said, but I think you would make a good pastor. And if God has called you, then he will enable you. I'm telling you guys, when my wife looked at me and said that, I mean, I just broke. My heart just... When the woman who knows you the best and lives with you 24/7 says, I think you'd be a good pastor and God will enable you. Oh my goodness, the courage and the confidence and the assurance that came into my life. And I looked at her and I said, wow, how long have you been sitting on all that? And she said, too long. She said, you got to reckon it with God, but that's what I think this is. Now, long story short, the next 2 months, God began to reassure me over and over through his word. It came down to about the second week of May. I surrendered to God on the night of May 11th. Late one night, 1:30 in the morning, I said to the Lord, okay, God, just I'm done. I'm done arguing. I'm done wrestling. I'm done negotiating. I'm done talking about it. I'm going to go wherever you tell me to go. And I'm going to do whatever you tell me to do. Just please give me a building. I don't want to build a building. I said, I'll go wherever you want me to go. He gave me a building that needed $1.5 million worth of work, but he gave me a building. But anyway, I got up the next morning. I said, God, you just have to point me where and show me that that's where you're leading. And over the next week, God began to say, Emmanuel, 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 in a multitude of ways, in a multitude of undeniable ways. It was mind-blowing. It was miraculous. And it all came down to this conversation that I had, very difficult conversation I had with Pastor Chapel, and expressing to him in compassion and with tears what God was doing in our lives. And a few days later, he asked me to pray and consider, And a few days later, I had to give him a final answer, and it was a Tuesday night, and we had had lots of counselors, maybe 25 or 30 men in their 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s, and it came down to this Wednesday morning where I knew I had to walk into the office of my employer and my friend and my pastor, and I knew I had to say, this is what we're doing. And I, at that time, still didn't know if we were going any. I didn't know if Emmanuel was in the picture or not. I just knew that God was calling us. And that Tuesday night, I said, God, I am totally surrendered. I'm going to do what you tell me to do. I'd like to have one more assurance. I don't think this was a fleece as much as it was, God, show me your word, show me your directive one more time. And I was, at that point, surrendered, but needed to kind of give a final, basically my resignation was going to happen the next morning. And it's no different than you guys. You walk into your employer's office and you resign. How are you going to support your family? How are you going to pay for your, I mean, what's going to happen? This was a flying leap off a cliff. And I thought, okay, well, at least I don't have cancer. It's like, you know, I mean, that's kind of how I was thinking at that point. God's saying, go jump off this cliff, throw it all away. I couldn't reason at all. I just knew that's what God was telling me to do. But I went to sleep that night. I said, God, could you just show me one more time? I'm going to wake up tomorrow. I'm going to open the Bible, and I'm going to do what you tell me to do. Well, that morning, Wednesday morning, 8 o'clock, I opened my Bible reading. I was going through a one-year plan, and that morning happened to be 1 Chronicles 19. And I'm just saying, God, talk to me. And I could keep you all night telling you all those specific ways God talked to me, but I'll tell you this, I'm reading this story that night, that morning, reading about Joab and Abishai, and I got to verse 13. I want you to look at it with me, and I'm almost done as we close. And I'm going to tell you what God did to me. Look at it again. Be of good courage. Let us behave ourselves valiantly for our people, for the cities of our God. And let the Lord do that which is good in his sight. I'm not Pentecostal. I'm not hearing God audibly, and he's never appeared to me visually. But this was absolutely as powerful as if he had. Sitting at my desk, 8 o'clock, and it was like God was sitting across the other side of that desk. I had my Bible open. In fact, it was that Bible laying there. And it was as though God pulled up and sat down in the chair right across from my desk. And when I got to verse 13, he stood up. He leaned over the desk. He grabbed me right here. And he pulled me up close to his face. And he said three things out of this verse. He said, be strong and of a good courage. And what I heard was, stop being so fearful. Now, this was not God screaming at me. This was my Heavenly Father pulling me really close to his face and almost whispering it in words that just nailed my, I mean, just thunder shook my heart. Be of good courage. It was like he's told me this for 6 months and 7 months and 8 months, and finally he's going to say, be of good courage. Stop being afraid. And then he said, behave valiantly for our people and for the cities of our God. And you know what that said to my spirit, my heart? You know what I heard him say to my spirit? This isn't about you. I'm sick of your arguments. I'm sick of you talking about your material world. I'm sick of you worried about your circumstances and your situation and your home and your income and your needs and what you deserve and what you worked hard for. I'm tired of all that because this isn't about you. This is about my people, and this is about cities where I'm working, and this is about things that I'm doing, and you are mine, and I have an assignment for you, and I'm tired of you negotiating with me over your material world. So stop behaving cowardly in self-interest and start behaving valiantly in selfless interest. Consider the people who are impacted by this. This isn't about you. This is about other cities, and namely one named Newington that I was relatively unfamiliar with at the time. what God was saying is, I'm not only working in this one place. There's another spiritual battle. There's another field I want you to go to. And there's people there that are going to be impacted. People like Sarah, whose story I told you. And God just said, stop arguing with me about you. This is not about you. And then at the end of the verse, let the Lord do that which is good in his sight. Now, guys, I got to tell you, for 6 and 7 months, I didn't see any good thing in this. And what God said to me in that moment is, I only do good things. And what you think is bad, and what you think is risky, and what you think is so loss-oriented, yeah, it's an abandonment. From your side of the equation, you're losing everything. From your side of the equation, you're abandoning everything. But from my side of the equation, Cary, I'm doing something good. It may not be good in your sight, but that's irrelevant because it's good in my sight. Amen. And guys, when God comes to you and says, be courageous, you can set aside your fear and you can be courageous because your Heavenly Father's got your back. And when God says to you, be valiant for our people and for the cities of our God, He's saying, get your eyes off yourself and look at the people I've called you to love and live for their best interest and live for their spiritual health and live for their flourishing. And then when God says, let me do what is good in my sight, what He's saying is, put aside what you can't see is good. And listen, cancer. When God allowed me to have cancer, I didn't see the good in that. But I've seen 10 years of harvest from that. I would never go back. I would never undo the harvest that God's brought from that cancer battle. God only does good things. But He calls you to let Him. He calls you to relinquish the fight. Valiant behavior is courageous in the face of fear. It is selfless and compassionate for the good of others. And it does always what is right at the right time for the right reasons, but it is obedient. It is confident in obedience to God. Guys, I don't know how God might be using this in your life, but I know this. Those that God's given you to love will be impacted for generations if you will behave valiantly. But valor requires you to do the hard thing. And it requires you to trust your God and to trust that He is doing something good in the hard things He calls you to. Be of good courage, men. Let us behave ourselves valiantly for our people, for the cities of our God. Let the Lord do that which is good in His sight. I wrote that verse down on a card. I started to weep immediately at my desk. I wrote it down on a card. I couldn't even talk. The phone rang, my desk, picked it up. The secretary said, Pastor wants you to come see him. I put that little 3x5 card in my pocket. I knew I was being called into the office to give a final resignation answer or to accept a new job there. I was being given two choices. And I walked in, and I was crying when I walked into his office. It was probably one of the most painful moments of my life. I stood there, and I just reached into my pocket, and I took the card, and I said, I whispered it because I couldn't say it, this is my answer. And I just sat down and wept. And I didn't know what God was going to do. The last 7.5 years, I wouldn't change one thing about the story. God is good, and He will use you if you'll let Him. Let's have our heads bowed and our eyes closed. Father, I pray that right now we would reckon with You. I pray that we would be like Joab and Abishai, and that we would let our lives